Good morning, everybody. Happy Friday. We have an amazing show for everybody today. What do we have, Krystal?
Indeed. Well, of course, South Carolina primary is tomorrow, so we're going deep on the Palmetto State. We've got two reports on the ground, one from Jordan Sheridan, who's been talking to activists and door knockers out there to get a sense of what the voters are actually telling people at the doors. And also Paul Steinhauser, great journalist from New Hampshire, who's been going to all these primary states and has provided us with invaluable insights. We also are going to focus a little bit on coronavirus. Jason Miller, who's doing a podcast, what is it called, with Steve Bannon?
War Room Pandemic. He's former Trump communications director. He's got some contra thoughts to how the administration has handled it. I'm really glad to get his insights.
Yes.
It's going to be interesting.
So that'll be interesting. But let's start with just sort of lay of the land in terms of South Carolina, where we are, what the polls are saying.
So the polls are absolutely all over the map. In general, Joe Biden seems to hold a wide lead, some of the latest polling, but some polling has it only within 4 points. And so it's kind of a hot mess coming out of South Carolina. We have like 6 or 7 different polls in the last couple of days that range from 24 points up, like I said, with a 4-point gap. Now, one really important point to note is that the polls in South Carolina have traditionally underestimated the strength of the front runner.
Right.
So Barack Obama massively outperformed his polls. Hillary Clinton massively outperformed her polls in the last time around. So generally, it looks like Joe Biden seems to have strength going up there. That being said, look, all the fundamentals for a Bernie upset win absolutely exist. It just is really a matter of whether he's been able to chip into that, some of that Biden support, and flip it. I'm not sure if any of that is there, though.
Right. Well, let's take a look at a couple of the polls. We've got the Monmouth poll, which shows a fairly significant Biden lead here, 20-point Biden lead, with Bernie just edging out Tom Steyer there. On the other hand, we also have a Data for Progress poll. Now, they've been very accurate,
right,
and it shows a narrower, still Biden in the lead, but a narrower lead for him and a more significant gap between Sanders and Steyer there. To your point about the polls being all over the map, I will say the post-debate, the post-Nevada polls and the post-debate polls all have consistently shown Biden with a lead. The other thing that's interesting about the, you know, the front runner usually is underpolled in the state. I mean, one way of looking at it is the front runner is usually underpolled. The other way is that it's a hard state to poll.
It's a very difficult state.
Hard to know who's going to turn out. Hard to know which way that they are ultimately swinging and shifting. I think Biden did enough in this debate this week and did enough in Nevada to give himself a case to make. Let's not forget, this guy led by 50 points in the state at one point.
Right.
The fact that it's even in doubt at all is kind of astonishing.
Yeah, that is very bad for him. And again, I mean, what path does this guy have forward, realistically? The only path forward is that he is able to get the 15% threshold in Texas, in Florida, and all these other big delegate states, possibly even California, where he's right on the edge of that 15% qualification. And that is where I think his real path forward is, which is broker convention.
Yeah.
Another thing we should talk about here is that if Elizabeth Warren doesn't come in, you know, she comes in fourth, fifth, that's where she's generally projected to. She is right now, we're going to talk about this later in the show, she is losing in her own home state.
Yeah.
When you're losing in your own home state, you almost certainly have to drop out. And so, look, I don't know. What do you think? Do you think she'll drop out if she loses Massachusetts? I just feel like you cannot hold your head high as a candidate when you lose your own home state
and
go into California.
Adam Green, who's, you know, friend of the show and always comes on and makes a case for Elizabeth Warren, was on, I think, MSNBC yesterday. Yeah, he was getting pressed by Katie Turr about, do you expect Warren to win any states? And how do you make the case that she's like the unity candidate if she can't win any states? And he wouldn't commit to the idea that she would win even her own home state. She also hasn't come out and declared that she expects to win her own home state. So it's already a very hard argument to make. You actually lose in Massachusetts. I think it's very hard to persist at that point.
That's another reason that I'm looking forward to that map and Biden's viability is right now Warren actually has number two place in California, the most delegate rich state. And I think that if she loses her own home state, that the punishing, remember that that's also on the East Coast, right?
Right.
And so we're going to know that while polls are basically still open in California or roughly around that time. I just think that the punishing news cycle of irrelevance from whatever she's going to place in South Carolina, we don't know where that is going to be, could make it so that actually poised for a Biden and Bloomberg to both hit the 15% threshold in California. I think that really is kind of the nightmare scenario for Bernie.
Yeah. I mean, what has she gotten so far? Third in Iowa was her best finish.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, right. Exactly. I mean, that's not strong. How do you make the case that you're the person who should be, you know, the unity candidate? Look, none of these people other than Bernie at this point are playing for a majority. Mm-hmm. None of them really is even playing for a plurality at this point. They're all just playing to keep Bernie under a majority so that they can try to take it from him at the convention.
And get, you know, within, if you get within 100 delegates, there's a, you know, I'm not saying it's a good argument, but there's an argument that you can plausibly make. The press will all jump on board.
The closer they can make it, then you can say, like, oh, if we add up Biden and
Pete, Bloomberg, yes.
Or Biden and Bloomberg. Oh, my God, can you imagine that ticket? That's horrifying. That's horrible to think about. No, I think more likely would be you add up Biden and Pete together and you get, you know, or Biden and Klobuchar together or whatever, and you get more than Bernie got. And so if we put all the moderates together, that's what people really want. And that's how they justify this whole thing. I was watching CNN last night, Thomas Friedman, columnist, another perpetually wrong person, professional wrong person, Thomas Friedman.
The world is flat, folks.
On with Chris Cuomo last night. And he's been penning these op-eds about how, about the Super Friends unity ticket, let's like put everybody together in one administration.
Yeah, it's
a, like, you know, fanfic of how to take this away from Bernie Sanders. But he made a new case last night, which was quite novel, which we may be hearing more of, which is that coronavirus is going to be the thing that totally upends this race, and it will be the justification for taking it from Bernie, even if he is winning in the delegate count. Let's take a listen to what he has to say.
We're in a really evolving moment now, Chris, with this coronavirus. I really hope that in 2 weeks it's in our rearview mirror and things are back under control. But what if it isn't? What if this is Katrina times 10? And I think if it is, you could see the public looking for a leader who has two things that are very, very important in this kind of situation. One, experience in managing a crisis, and two, an ability to pull together a coalition and build trust across both intra-party and outside of the party. And I think those demands and requirements could really damage Bernie Sanders, who is not seen as someone who played well with others in the Senate. He has one of the worst records of doing that. And he's seen as a very dogmatic ideologue. I think Biden, Bloomberg, Buttigieg, Amy Klobuchar, Elizabeth Warren, they all, could they all could be viewed differently, Chris. In 2 weeks, we could be looking for a very different candidate.
It's just amazing what these people are able to ignore in their, like, increasingly elaborate fantasies about how people will really come to see the truth about Bernie Sanders. I mean, he talks about the ability to bring in a broad coalition. Who has the broadest coalition in the field, right?
Also,
why is Bernie Sanders winning right now? He's winning because people trust him on health care. What are we talking about with coronavirus?
So, I don't know what the hell he's talking. I mean, for a guy who purports to explain history to the masses, let's go to history and look at global pandemics and global outbreaks and recessions. What do people vote for? They vote for revolutionary, big change candidates. I actually think coronavirus, and if Trump does not handle it properly, it absolutely could sink him. It could be a Katrina-level moment. I was so outraged when I saw Larry Kudlow out on CNBC saying, we have contained the virus.
Right.
And now there's a new case of outbreak in California, and there's all this news about how health officials didn't wear protective gear when they were transferring passengers from the Diamond cruise ship to the United States. I mean, it's just like, look, we should acknowledge that this thing could go pandemic. It could be a disaster. The government should be literally having a daily, you know, when they have hurricanes, they have daily press conference. All the guys in the jackets show up and they're like, here's the eye of the storm. Here's what we got. That's like a type of communication that we should be having from the Trump administration. They have tried to basically try and not spook the markets. Doesn't matter. The market corrected. It's down by like 11%.
Yep.
One of the biggest, you know, 3-day drops since the financial crisis. So they need to get it real, and I think that Bernie is actually any like anti-establishment candidate is perfectly poised to pick up the pieces. Look at Trump's appeal during ISIS, right? It was a huge part of why people voted for Trump. The Orlando attack, San Bernardino, all these other things. People felt like things were truly out of control, ISIS storming across Syria. You can't underestimate the way that these things actually appeal to the biggest, most anti-establishment.
That is very true. And yet you can see how people like Thomas Friedman and all the others.
That's how he thinks,
number one. And number two, you could see how they could use that narrative to say, okay, yeah, those early states, that was one thing. That's before we had the coronavirus pin, and now everything is different. So we should just invalidate those results and go with, you know, what we, the party elites, what we, those who know are in the know, tell you poor voters is the right thing to do. You could see how this could play out.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you can absolutely see it. I think it's incredibly foolish, like most of the things that he's written. But it's like, that's, I'm beginning to see that they're grasping at any straw that they possibly can to justify it to themselves. That's kind of what they did with Trump. They're like, oh, well, you know, if the bottom falls out, then we could replace him. Or like, you know, I mean, they would constantly grasp at things to say like, oh, we can take him off the ticket and make Pence the nominee and write it. And I was like, you guys are out of your mind. That's not going to happen.
Right.
It's going to be Trump and Hillary.
This is what's on the ballot. This is what we're voting on. Which side are you on? I mean, bottom line, right?
That really is weird.
And, you know, we called this months, remember months ago, we talked about how what they'll say is the Republicans should have intervened to stop Trump, and they didn't do it. And we are the patriots who are going to step up when our own party is flirting with this outrageous demagogue, and we will set things straight. You can see how it all happened, and they will make themselves out to be patriots and morally justified, and a certain segment of the party will certainly go along with it, but the people will see through it. Like, you can't just have this whole illusion of voting and organizing and rallies and all of this and tell people that their votes matter, and then in the end say, like, well, that's nice. That's cute that that's the candidate you want, but we don't like him, so we're going in this direction.
Yeah, it's the most anti-democratic thing you can think of. And that's how, you know, when Rahm Emanuel was like the famous never let a good crisis go to waste, the establishment thinks that too, and they're going to try and use it in order to get whatever power they can back.
Yep. Buckle your seatbelts. You're going to see more of that. We're going to tell you what's on our radar, so that's next.